Endometrial carcinoma and endometrial hypertrophy is a very, very important area for the examiner. Endometrial hypertrophy is a precancerous stage. What are the different types of hyperplasia that you know? Simple, that is cystic hyperplasia without any atypia, where there is only a glandular and stromal proliferation. Only 1% chances of the progression, but these percentages are important. Examiner will keenly ask it. Complex is adenomatous hyperplasia without atypia, where only the glandular proliferation is present. 3% progression is what we need to appreciate. So you can see a typical uterus, normal endometrium versus an endometrium which has undergone a hypertrophic change basically. Atypical, it can be of two types. Simple atypical, which progresses about 10% of times towards cancer, and complex atypical, which progresses 29% of times towards the cancer, and proliferation with cytological atypia. So they are all the important subtypes. So doctor, this is cyclical hyperplasia versus simple hyperplasia is what you are able to see. This is an example of a histology of what is called atypical hyperplasia in contrast to simple hyperplasia. So how do you diagnose a case of endometrial hyperplasia is a very, very important question. It is the endometrial biopsy which is considered to be the gold standard is what we need to basically remember, doctor. Endometrial biopsy, which is considered to be an important gold standard. Yeah. Pap smear, is there any role? If endometrials glandular cells are found. Generally, on a pap smear, you expect a squamous cell, atypical squamous cell to be found. But if there is a glandular cells found on pap smear, that also is an indication. Then endocervical area, you can do curettage, which is contraindicated in pregnancy. Then always transvaginal ultrasound is the one which is used, where you take a endometrial stripe in a postmenopausal woman using it. Then hysteroscopy, using it you can be able to do the uterine curettage. Suppose if a simple endometrial biopsy is inadequate, then you can do hysteroscopic biopsy of the uterus is the various ways by which you can evaluate. But if the examiner asks a question, what is the gold standard? Endometrial biopsy. Now, how do you treat endometrial hyperplasia? Suppose if it is a simple hyperplasia histologically without atypia with abnormal bleeding, then cyclically you can give progestins. If it is a complex hyperplasia or a simple atypical hyperplasia, how do you want to manage? This also by cyclical or continuous progestin therapy. Suppose if already woman completed her pregnancy, since this finding in future is going to have a chance of converting into malignancy, hysterectomy is indicated. We are getting some voice disturbance. I hope the voice is loud and clear. Yeah. Now, complex atypical hyperplasia, how do you want to manage? These are all one of the favorite areas which are asked as questions. You must be very sure, like a consultant gynecologist and obstetrician, to answer them. Continuous high dose, there is no role for the cyclical progestin if it is complex atypical. Because complex atypical may, you have a chance of 29% progressing towards malignancy. If at all uterine preservation is required, then continuous high dose progestin. If it is not required, that becomes an indication for hysterectomy, is what need to be remembered. Now comes the endometrial cancer. What are you going to remember about it, doctor? It is arising from the endometrium, and lot of times endometrial cancer will lead to clinical bleeding. That's the reason diagnosis is not really delayed. Not really delayed. You can take this phone. I think this will go on continuous bus. Can keep it on. Yeah. And since symptoms are so obvious, endometrial cancer is often diagnosed at quite a early stage, is what need to be remembered. Okay, doctor. Then what is the lifetime risk? 3% is the chance any woman can develop. Most of the times, more than 50 years is the time, which is the median age of diagnosis in 80% of cases, is what you need to ultimately remember. So doctor, we have the endometrial cancer under a artist depiction, basically, which is arising from the endometrial lining from the fundus. Now, there are two types of endometrial malignancies. Type 1 is most common. I mean, the hyperplasia, which is predisposing to the development of the endometrial malignancy. Type 1 is most common. It is a estrogen-dependent neoplasm, basically. And it is the proliferation of the normal tissue hyperproliferating under the influence of the estrogen will ultimately convert into endometrial malignancy. And the type 2, though there is no hyperestrogenic state, though there is no precursor in the form of endometrial hyperplasia, if the endometrial cancer develops de novo, then it is called type 2. Type 2 generally without a hyperestrogenic state, if somebody developed endometrial cancer, means it has got a higher rate and it is a more dirty tumor to handle, which is more aggressive in nature. So what are the clinical presenting features? Abnormal bleeding, 90% of cases. Postmenopausal bleeding, classical symptom of the endometrial hyperplasia. It can present with excessive bleeding like menorrhagia, or it can be intermenstrual bleeding as in carcinoma cervix, as metrorrhagia. Any of them can be the presenting features. Abnormal pap smear also is the way the story of the endometrial cancer will start unrevealing. I mean, revealing itself, unraveling itself. But if you take pap smear in case of endometrial cancer, it only will alert you. It is not diagnostic. If there are abnormal glandular cells of unknown significance on a pap smear can have squamous cytology and glandular cytology. Abnormal glandular cells of unknown significance, then it warrants a further investigation to probe into the possibility of endometrial cancer. So what are the differential diagnosis of the postmenopausal bleeding, doctor? Because postmenopausal bleeding is a typical clinical vignette. A patient in her 50s presenting with postmenopausal bleeding is the starting line of the story called endometrial cancer. So what are the differential diagnosis? If a woman is on a hormone replacement therapy postmenopausally, that also can lead to bleeding. Any atrophic endometritis due to the menopause can slough out, leading to postmenopausal bleeding. Endometrial cancer, endometrial polyp, cervical polyp, any coagulopathy, endometrial hyperplasia itself, any of them can lead to postmenopausal bleeding. One of the most frequently asked MCQ in the exam about endometrial cancer is, what are the risk factors? Any unopposed estrogenic activity, like as in polycystic ovarian syndrome, any estrogen producing tumor like a granulosa cell tumor of the ovary, or any liver disease, because normally a healthy liver is the one which metabolizes the estrogen. If the liver disease is there, then hyperestrogenism will be there. That's the reason in the case of the men, it leads to Liver disease leads to gynecomastia due to that excess estrogen. In women, it can be predisposing factor for endometrial cancer. Any previous history of radiation exposure of the uterus, for example, any uterine sarcoma, if you treat it, then that can lead to endometrial malignancy. Obesity, 2 to 5 times increased risk is there, and a very early menarche or a late menopause are the states of a higher estrogen exposure. Similarly, nulliparity. In a nulliparous woman, there is a 2 to 3 times increased risk of developing endometrial cancer, is what you have to basically remember. Then diabetes mellitus, 2.8 times increased risk is there in the patients who have diabetes. Hypertension, risk factor for, because hypertension is a state of atherosclerosis, and it simply means to say there is a increased steroidogenesis in them due to the excess availability of the precursors of the steroids. And there's a reason, presence of hypertension, diabetes, they both are also considered to be risk factors for endometrial cancer, is what need to be remembered. Then if there is an endometrial hyperplasia, depending upon the type of histology, highest risk is there if there is a complex atypia, is what need to be remembered. Then if the woman is taking tamoxifen treatment, tamoxifen is a estrogen selective estrogen receptor modulator. It may be antagonistic on the breast, but it is pro to the receptors in endometrium. That's the reason tamoxifen selective estrogen receptor modulator can promote the endometrial hyperplasia just like estrogen, and can predispose to the development of endometrial cancer. Any unopposed estrogen stimulation like menopausal estrogen replacement, if you do, it may protect against developing fractures, but it will promote the endometrial cancer, where 4 to 8 times increased risk is noted. And any familial predisposition also need to be remembered. Now, what are the protective factors is a very, very important question. If there is a regular ovulation, or if the woman is taking a combined OCP, don't combine the two. Combined OCP lead to an ovulation. But combined OCP is a protective factor against endometrial cancer because of the presence of the progesterone inside it. And also regular ovulation. So we will love to give this kind of things as MCQs in exam. If you start first time reasoning in the exam hall, you will go wrong. Thinking that a combined OCP lead to an ovulation, regular ovulation is opposite to that. Can both of them can be protective? We get doubts in the exam hall. Don't get doubt. Both of them are protective. Smoking and multiparity. But don't ask your patients to smoke just for this purpose. Now, how do you diagnose a case of postmenopausal bleeding? We do endometrial biopsy and dilatation curettage through hysteroscopy. If at all the endometrial biopsy is inadequate, then hysteroscopic curettage also is indicated. Now, let us see. This is a classical example of how a endometrial biopsy, which is being done, which is considered to be a very important investigation in the diagnosis of endometrial cancer. So a catheter is basically passed and it will be plucking out the endometrial lining out of the uterus, which is then being subjected to microscopic examination. So this is once more how a endometrial biopsy curette is being passed pervaginally in case of endometrial biopsy. Now, what are the histological subtypes of endometrial cancer? We have endometrioid type, which is basically ciliated adenocarcinoma. It is the most common type of histology, endometrioid type of endometrial cancer. Papillary serous is found in about 10%, but it carries a poor prognosis. And papillary serous type can occur even in the people who don't have hyperestrogenism also. And it acts more or less like the ovarian cancer. You have a serous, papillary serous cancers are there, no? Like that it will act. And typically by the time it presents, papillary serous, patient will be in stage 4 with a poor prognosis is what need to be remembered. Similarly, clear cell is another variety with poor prognosis. Sarcomas are also poor prognosis. Poorly differentiated carcinomas also poor prognosis. So the most common type, luckily endometrioid, carries a relatively better prognosis. It is preceded by a hyperestrogenic state is what need to be remembered. Now comes the favorite area of the examiner. Staging of the endometrial carcinoma. You must be able to remember it at the tip of your nose and sneeze it in the exam hall. Now doctor, how do you stage? Based on the spread of the tumor in the uterus, the amount of myometrial invasion, whether extra uterine spread is there of the tumor or not, they are all the important deciding factors. So how do you stage? Only at surgery you can be able to stage. Surgical staging, just like in ovarian cancer. For a ovarian or a endometrial cancer to be staged, it is the laparotomy and surgical staging is the one which gives a precise assessment. And staging has a great bearing on the ultimate prognosis, type of treatment, etc., etc., in case of endometrial cancer. So how do we stage? It is confined only to uterus endometrial cancer. Then you call stage 1, doctor. 1A means less than half of the myometrium. 1B means invasion more than half of the myometrium. Then what is stage 2? Endometrial cancer which is invading the cervical stroma. It is supposed to be located where? In the body of uterus and the endocervical canal. But it is going all the way into cervical stroma. But it is not extending beyond the uterus, you call it as stage 2. Let us see. You can see this is the endometrium and tumor is only limited to the endometrium, that becomes stage 1A, less than half. Invasion, more than half actually, of the myometrium, then you call it as stage 1B. So this is how the endometrial cancer, based upon its degree of invasion, that helps you to stage the endometrial cancer. So invasion to more than one half of the myometrium as what you can see. Then ultrasound also helps a lot in making up the diagnosis of the endometrial thickness, amount of invasion. All those features can very much be graded based upon the ultrasound evaluation. Then what is stage 2A? If there is a spread to the cervix with the endocervical glandular involvement only, is a way to say it is 2A. Then if it is spreading to the cervix with the involvement of the cervical stroma also, then it becomes the stage 2B. Only cervical endometrium only involved is 2A, cervical stroma also becomes 2B. Then what is stage 3? Regional spread of the endometrial cancer. 3A means the uterine serosa or the adnexa of the uterus are involved. 3B means vagina and parametrial tissues are involved. 3C means pelvic or para-aortic lymph nodes are involved. And 3C1 means pelvic nodes, 3C2 means positive para-aortic lymph nodes. Any of them can become a question in the exam. If you go through the previous All India, AIMS, PGI, any exam, CLAB, USMLE, any exam, endometrial cancer staging is very important because that has a bearing on the prognosis and treatment. So if the tumor is invading the serosa or adnexa with a positive peritoneal cytology, when you do the peritoneal wash, then you call stage 3A. Vaginal metastasis are the hallmark of stage 3B. Pelvic end, the spread to the retroperitoneal lymph nodes will make it stage 3C. Once more, 3C1 and C2. Then stage 4. Once bladder or the bowel mucosa is involved, you call 4. Bowel and bladder mucosa is 4A and distant metastasis to the abdomen and the inguinal lymph nodes, very important. Lot of times examiner will ask, inguinal lymph node got involved, what is the stage of the endometrial cancer? Becomes a question a good number of times. 4B is what you are going to ultimately conclude. So, in the stage 4A, there is an invasion of the bladder and the bowel mucosa. But once it is 4B, you can see, these are the inguinal lymph nodes, doctor. If the inguinal lymph nodes are involved, or the intra-abdominal organs, liver, spleen, everywhere, if there are mets, then that qualifies to be 4B. Lot of times students confuse where to place inguinal lymph nodes in the staging. Whenever this question comes in the tomorrow's exam, you should remember emphatically, endometrial cancer, inguinal lymph nodes is stage 4B. I want to re-emphasize to you, doctor. So, endometrial cancer, diagnosed, staged, how are you going to manage? But before that, there is one more step called grading. G1 means well differentiated with less than 5% of solid pattern. G2 means moderately differentiated, 5 to 50% solid pattern. And G3 means more than 50% solid pattern is what you have to basically understand. Suppose if your endometrial curettage is insufficient through a CAT, then hysteroscopy and hysteroscopic biopsy is indicated. The transvaginal ultrasound can guide you very well in order to take a biopsy specimen in the evaluation of the endometrial cancer. So, doctor, how are you going to treat? Whatever be the stage, certain things are to be done because it is a surgical staging which is important for endometrial and ovarian cancer. So, first to do surgery. What type of surgery you want to do? Total abdominal hysterectomy with bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy with pelvic and para-aortic lymphadenectomy with peritoneal washings for cytology. For any stage, because this itself will help you to do the staging. Then after the above steps, depending upon the stage, we decide the adjuvant therapy. Suppose if it is stages 1 or 2, what do you want to do? We give adjuvant radiation therapy, which includes a internal and external radiation is what you will basically deliver. Stage 3 to 4, we give adjuvant external beam radiation and hormone therapy also is indicated. So, if you take the progestin therapy, what will progestin will do? It will lead to endometrial atrophy. So, progestin therapy is the one which is often used as an adjuvant. Hormonal therapy is what need to be remembered. So, that is the reason, just like in breast cancer, where we do the receptor status assessment, we also do it in the case of endometrial cancer also. If the cancer is progesterone receptor positive, then there is a 70% 5-year survival. If it is progesterone receptor negative, then only 15 to 20% of 5-year survival is what you need to ultimately remember. So, when do you give adjuvant chemotherapy, doctor? So, basically, chemotherapy is also indicated as a possible therapeutic option in stage 3 to stage 4. Doxorubicin, cisplatin, carboplatin and paclitaxel are the various adjuvant chemotherapy options which are available is what you have to basically remember. So that is all the story, doctor, which you need to be very sure.